We have four kindergarten kids that are now reading on a level 6, which means that they've really passed the benchmark for the end of the year already. So they're doing really well. But of course, we always want to teach them where they are and take them further. So as we were pre-briefing this morning, Peggy and Lori shared some things about the children. And so I just wanted you to real quickly summarize, what is our purpose for today's lesson for your children, Peggy?
Well, my two children, they are very good when they come to a word that they don't know, a challenging word. They're very good at getting their mouth ready with the first sound. But they then they sort of freeze. If they can't get it by looking at the picture and the initial sound, then they freeze and they just can't seem to move on.
Right. And that's very typical. In fact, the normal progression of attending to print is they look at the beginning, they look at the beginning and the end, and then they look at the middle last. Which is why when you have some children at 12s and 14s, their errors usually match the beginning and end, and they don't match the middle. So they're following the natural progression, and that's where our focus is going to be. Lori, and would you like to share a little bit about your children?
Well, I guess obviously the same thing, but I think also at this level I find that they're really confident, and then they're just guessing because they think they know the word. Mm-hmm. And so it's kind of almost pulling them back a little bit to look a little more carefully at what they're doing.
Exactly. The attention to print is really what we're focusing on for the most part in this lesson. The other thing is, I'll talk more about this afternoon, but when children are just learning to read, we focus a lot about reading the sight words because we know that's going to help them do well. But if we don't also teach them to write the sight words, what happens is they get the idea that writing is all about hearing sounds and words. And it's just about phonemic awareness. Now, phonemic awareness is really important. But there's a part of this brain that needs to cross the phonemic awareness, the sounds, with visual. In fact, if I know you worked with Roberta. And there's a little chart that Marie Clay has in her books that looks something like this. I probably have the words out of order. But anyways, it's four boxes: meaning, visual, structure, and letters and sounds. And then she has these arrows, you know, crossing every single which way are these arrows. Well, we tend to go meaning, visual, and structure, right? That's what we analyze for. But these letters and sounds, what is that? That's the phonemic awareness. Okay, that's hearing the sounds and words. And we know that's a critical part of reading as well. But in reading, these very much match. And that's why we only analyze for meaning, structure, and visual. In other words, the visual, the letter, and sounds go together quite well. You know, I might not be able to, you know, decode come, but I could, by the first sound, I can think about my story and figure it out. But in spelling, these are two different processes. That in went, I just have to remember what it looks like. I can kind of sound that one out, but why? Let's take a good why. You know, I can't sound that one out in writing, so I just have to remember what it looks like. That's the visual. Or a good one is said, which is the sight word we're going to work on today. Said, they think that writing is all about stretching out the sounds and saying S-E-D. The more they write said S-E-D, though, the more it's internalized as S-E-D. Mm-hmm. So in my progression of my emergent lessons, from the very beginning, I emphasize the importance of teaching children how to write the sight words, not just read them, so that you are working on that processing in the brain that's crossing between, I have to know what the word looks like, and I also have to think about what it sounds like. Now, there's a third type of spelling strategy that's going to come into play. It's usually not in kindergarten. You'll see it in first grade. So it's sounding out words is one strategy for spelling. Remember what it looks like is one strategy. And the third strategy is analogies, word families. They're not usually going to use that in kindergarten. You know, even though we spend so much time going cat, bat, fat, mat, cat, they usually go for the sound rather than the analogy. But they'll start to do that more so in the later levels. Okay, so we're ready for the kiddos. Good morning. Come and have a seat. Patrick, can you sit right there?
And this is, tell me your name, buddy. I have bad eyes. What is his name?
Darrell.
Darrell?
Drew.
I remember now.
D-R-E-W.
Thank you. And Catherine. And?
Avery.
And I'm Miss Jan, and I'm going to do your lesson today for you, okay? So go ahead and pick up your markers. We're going to start with our words.
Do you have a marker there?
Oh, sweetie, let me give you a marker. Oh, he has two, that's why. He's got two erasers as well. Okay, you need an eraser. Put your mark in one hand and your eraser in the other. Okay, now, in these words, boys and girls, you're going to have to remember what they look like. So I'm going to give you a word. You can't really sound it out. You've got to remember what it looks like, okay? Write the word here. I like the way you're writing it in secret. Go ahead and erase. Good, erase. There's one more letter. It's a silent one. Erase. There you go. Erase. So if I were to be taking my check marks, I would give two check marks, but when I have to prompt, I don't give a check mark, because what that means is it's not independent yet. They just need a little bit of help. But tomorrow, they'll have it. Okay? Erase. Now I want you to write the word look. Letter to that to make it say looks? That's something we're going to be looking at today is the end of the word, looks. What would you put there for looks?
I already did it.
You already did it, yes. What letter says? There you go. Okay, erase it. And the last word is come. It's a tricky one. Think about that second letter. Starts with this. You're so close. Come. What's that next sound? Come. Let's go ahead and spell it. Ready? C-O-M-E. Now, when I see that 3 out of 4 needed help, I go back and reteach that word. And don't introduce a new one until they have that one, because that one is such an important word. Okay? Erase. Good job. Put your marker and your eraser back, please. And today you're going to read a story called Winter Recess. And this is a story about some children who are getting ready to go outside for recess, but it's very cold and snowy outside. So we're going to read to find out what are some of the clothes they have to put on before they can go out for recess. Okay, so don't forget to turn the page. Winter Recess. We're just going to look at the pictures first and get an idea of what they're putting on, okay? Look at the teacher. She's looking at her watch. What do you think she might be saying?
What time is it?
What time is it? Or it's time for recess? Find the word time. Now, the reason why Peggy identified that as a word to introduce is because it's the first word of the story, and that's not a known word. Okay, look at the next page. What are they doing now, Drew? Can you tell what they're putting on?
I know what they're putting on. Snow pants.
Ah, turn the page. Now we can see what they're putting on in this page. I'm not going to talk about it, but you can see what they're putting on, okay? Okay, look at the next page. Think to yourself, what are they putting on? Okay, next page. What are they putting on this page, Patrick? What are those?
Gloves.
They could be gloves or mittens. So you'll have to read to find out, are they gloves or mittens? Okay. Next page. See what's happening? Turn the page. On this last page, you can see, are they going out or are they coming in? Can you tell?
Going out.
All right, you'll have to read and see. Are they going out or are they coming in? But there's one word I wanted you to find. It's a little bit tricky. It's the word O. On the very last page, can you find the word O? Last page, darling. All the way to the end. There it is. That's right. You're going to be seeing that word in a lot of books. Oh. And there's one more word in this page that I want to introduce to you. And you're going to be seeing a lot of these words now, boys and girls. It's called a contraction, and it has this little apostrophe here. And what this means is it's a short word for a longer two words. And this we would say, this part is it, and it's its, but it means the same as it is. So we could say, it's time to go to lunch, or we could say, it is time to go to lunch. But when you're reading it today, you're going to say,
It's.
Okay, when you finish reading the story, what should you do? Read it again. Start reading. Okay, whisper read. Winter recess. Oh, and I forgot to tell you, boys and girls, you don't need to point anymore with your fingers because you already know how to look at the board. So no pointing with your fingers. Read with your eyes, okay? Say that. Would she say time for recess? Do you think she's excited?
Time for recess.
Yeah, I think she might be excited that there's recess. Mm-hmm. Okay, keep going, boys and girls.
Time for recess.
When your teacher says it's time for recess, do you say yes? Or would you say yes?
Yes.
Would you be excited? What part of that word tells you it's excited? Keep going. Tells you it's exciting. Do you see that mark right there? Okay, so when we wouldn't just say yes, we would say yes. You see?
Yes.
Okay, keep going. Anything that you can do to help yourself? What do you see there that you know? Is there a part in there that you know? You know this part. And we add the Y to it, and that says, check your picture and think what it says. Could it be the or they? What do you think? Could it be they?
Kids.
Would that make sense? There you go. Good girl. Good. Would that make sense? They put on hair? No. Can you cover the ending in that word for me? What's the ending in that word? Good. Can you put your finger over it? And what do you have now? Good. Cover the ending on this word right here. And what's that part? Good. That's one of my teaching points, so I'm making sure I address it as they read. Keep going. Can you read that for me again, please? What would make sense? The kids. Good. Now, Drew, do you see what I did? I went back and reread, and that helped you, didn't it? You know what to do, sweetheart. Okay? Oh, you'll get stuck? Go ahead and try that again. So, the next time you get stuck, I want you to go back and read it, okay? Because that'll help you keep going. Did that make sense? Oh, no, said the time. Who do you think is saying
that?
Good, Patrick. Think about your story. And what did they just do? They went out for
recess.
Could that be recess? Okay. What can you do to help yourself? Recess is, you know that part. What would make sense then?
Would it look right?
Check your fingers. See if that could be over. Over. What do you think? Yeah. Okay, try that again.
Recess is over.
Beautiful. Read that page for me again, and then you can go back to the beginning. No finger, sweetie.
The kids won't have the door. Oh, no.
She the teacher. What do you think?
Said,
let's go.
Recess is over.
Now let's read that last one together. Ready? Recess is over. It's time to go in. Good. Read that page for me. I like the way you're thinking about your exclamation point, Avery. Keep going.
Yes, come on. Let's go. But the kids put the kids put on the kids on the kids and they come on.
What can you do, Catherine, to help yourself? Okay, I want you to do two things, sweetie. I want you to get your mouth ready. You know how to say that part. And I want you to check your picture, okay? So I'll go back and read right here. You hear it, darling. Hear it. Say this part. See how that helped you? Keep going. Try that again and get your mouth ready, just like we did the last page. Ready? There you go. Read that last page for me.
No.
Okay, boys and girls, I'm going to stop you. What nice reading you did today. I just love the way you were thinking about your story and using your pictures, okay? There's a couple things that I want to show you. So I want you to go to page 7. This was a tricky page for a lot of you, okay? And when you got to this last part, you weren't really sure what was happening in this part. Yeah, could it be? And a lot of you did say get. I want you to look at this word. Could it be get? It makes sense. Check the middle. Could it be get?
Got.
Oh, sometimes we have to look real carefully at the middle, don't we? So get would make sense, but we have to check the middle. Let's try this one. Let's see. You kind of jumped the gun on me, but that's okay. I'm going to follow your lead here. Could this be run?
Ran.
Oh, how do you know it's not run, but it's ran? How do you know? What part tells you that?
The middle.
Because of the middle. So we have to be checking that middle, too. Okay, and there's one more piece I want you to look on page 7. When you read, and they got in, some of you stopped. Don't tell me the word. But what I want you to do is two things. Catherine, do you remember what the first thing I told you to do?
Sound it out.
Well, sound the first part. Mm-hmm. Sounding out may not help you, but if you give me the first sound, tell me the first sign. Sound. Ooh. And then check your picture. What would make sense? And they got in line. So I want you guys to be doing that without your teacher telling you. That's your job. When you get stuck, Your job is to get your mouth ready and check your picture, because that's going to help you. Excellent. So tell me, actually what I was going to do is attend to the endings, which we didn't really talk that much about, but still, we'll go ahead and do that. Would this be mitten or mittens?
Mittens.
Mittens, because you're looking here at the S, right? So we're going to go all the way through the end of the word as well. All right, now I have my question I want to ask you. So let's think about it. What did they put on first? Let's see if you remember your story. Tell me what they put on first.
Snow pants.
Good. What did they put on next, Drew, after their snow pants? You're close. After the snow pants, they put on their
coats.
Then hats. And finally, they put on their
boots.
Oh, they did put on their boots. Okay, so it was your. I messed up. So it was snow pants, and then it was
coats
and boots, hats. And what's the last thing they put on? Before they went out the door, mittens. Now, here's my question. Why do you think they put their mittens on last? Thumbs up if you think you've got an idea. Why did they put their mittens on last and not first? We got one, we got two. Why would you put your mittens on last? Think about this, Drew. If you put your mittens on first and you were trying to get your coat on, and you're trying to put your boots on, would it be easy or hard?
Hard.
Okay, now Patrick, talk to me about it.
If you put your mittens on first, you could only use your thumb because all the other ones would be
like, exactly. So could you? What would you have trouble doing, Avery?
You could have trouble putting on your jacket and putting on your snow pants.
Oh, you're so right. Okay, good job. Now, today we're going to learn the word said. That's a tricky word. You just have to remember what it looks like, okay? You all know the S, and you all get the D, but these are the two letters that are tricky.
Ed.
It says ed, but it's not an E. This is the part that's tricky. Spell it for me. S-A-I-D. And these two letters in the middle are what you're going to have to remember. So, Drew, what's missing?
A.
Good. Avery, what's missing?
I.
Patrick, what's missing?
A-I.
Catherine, spell the word.
S-A-I-D.
Good. Get your letters out of the clear cup. This one. This one. It makes sense. Go. Miss and fix. And when the children are doing this, it's important to notice that they do it in sequential order. You don't want them starting from the back. Okay, now these children aren't, but sometimes you'll see that. Good. You want to check your A? You want to put your stick on the right side? Good. Check your A. Very good. One more letter. Okay. Now, make it and stop. Okay? Mix it one more time and then stop. Fast as you can. Now you want to check the word with your finger. So put your finger there and check it. Said. Say the word. Said. Okay, put your letters in your cups. Okay, write with your finger and say said. Don't spell it now. I want you to say the word. Ready? Said. Go ahead and write it with your finger. As soon as I see you write it with your finger, you can write it with a marker.
I have two markers in here.
Okay, I'll take the big one. Okay, right set. Oh, remember that? Third letter's not an E. What is that? Third letter. Good job. See, what you're doing here is you're stretching the brain neurons and making them remember what it looks like. Good job. Excellent. Erase. Okay, now what I want you to do, I'm sorry, you're going to take the letters that are in this cup. Go ahead and put your markers away. You're going to take letters in this cup, you're going to dump them out, and you're going to line them up on the table. Line them up right there on the table.
I have no idea what this is.
You have no idea what this is. Okay. You'll figure it out, trust me.
Are we supposed to write said?
You're not supposed to do anything with those. Just line them up, just like Drew's doing. He's first. Line them up as fast as you can. Good job. Quick, quick.
Awesome.
this is a P. You have a P in there, so just make sure you turn that around. Okay? Take three letters and make it say hat. Oh, I love that. That's very good, Patrick. I love it when you're saying it. Excellent. Okay? Now add a letter to make it say chat. Very good, Drew. Oh, and I forgot to tell you, you're going to put your hat right down here so I can see it. Now, don't take any letters away. You need four letters for chat. Okay, you're close, Patrick. Ch. What two letters say ch? C-H. So you want to move that around so it's C-H. There you go. Okay, good. Now I'm going to teach you something. I want you to break this word. When I say break it, you're going to find the vowel and you're going to move it across like that. Okay? So break the word. Just pull that part over like that. Okay, now you pull it over. Okay, now take your finger and point to the first part and say it. Point to the second part and say it. At. Pull it, push them together, and what do you have?
Chap.
Good. I want you to change one letter to make it say chap. Check it with your finger. Okay. Oh, you're close. Let's go back to this and say, check it first and say chap. Does that say p? There you go. You're going to have to get rid of that one. There you go. Break it. Say it. Make it. Good. Change one letter to make it say chip. Check carefully. Where are you going to put that I? You're right, it is an I. Check it with your finger. Let's see which finger. Ch. If. What are you going to change? Well, we need the chip, don't we? There you go. This is just the right level of difficulty. Break it. Say it. Make it.
Ship.
Okay. Last one. Ship.
Ship. Ship.
Easy. Oops, let's go back to this. Now we have ch. What two letters say sh? Is it? Well, tell me what two letters say sh.
C-H.
Well, the C-H says ch. So what's it? S-H. It's okay. That just gives me something to do, and that's my job. Break the word. Break the word. Say it. Make it. Fabulous. Okay, put your letters back in your blue or your colored cup. And that'd be the end of the lesson. But I don't get to come back tomorrow. So did we bring their journals?
No, we didn't.
Oh, we didn't bring their journals. Do we have paper here?
There's some little journals on that table.
Right here. Perfect. There's three. We need one more.
I'll get you some more paper.
Now, at this level, when they're at a level six, they don't need their lines anymore. They're spacing for themselves, but I usually draw, oh, that's perfect. I usually draw a line across the text because what I'm working on now is making sure that they write the words on the line. Would somebody find a stapler and just staple that for me real quick?
There's a staple on that table.
I write the lines. And then eventually we'll move into handwriting paper. Oh, we got it. We're good.
Got it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Thanks. So I'm not drawing a line for every word. But they are going to be, I'm going to tell them when you're writing your words, well, your sentence today, I want you to write your words on the line. So take your pencil out, please. Whoops. You're going to write the sentence, you're going to write what the teacher said at the beginning of the story. What's one thing the teacher said at the beginning of the story? Think about it. So I want you to write, the teacher said, everybody write that, the teacher said, and then you think about what she said at the beginning of the story. Remember the? Let's go back and do the, okay? How do you spell the? Remember? Okay. Now, I'm looking for a couple things. I'm looking for a correct spelling of sight words. I'm also looking to see if they have applied the ch sound in teacher. And, of course, said needs to be spelled correctly. Now, what did she say? Good. Now, when you write that next word, I want to show you. See the line right there? Let me show you set, and then you'll be able to do the other ones. I want your letters to touch the line like that. Okay, you think you can do that for me? Okay, right, it's time for recess. Go ahead. What are you going to write? Okay. Good. Can you say teacher? Oh, excellent, Patrick. Good. And look at how, see how this word touches the line? I want you to try to make your next word touch the line. Can you do that? Okay, read your sentence.
Teacher.
Oh, it's not an E. Think about what it looks like. Remember that second letter you said?
Remember it, Drew? Yeah.
You are close. Right, can you know how to write it? Write it for me up here. Good. Now, what do you need to make it say it's? There you go. And I don't care about the apostrophe. If you emphasize that too much, what you're going to get is apostrophes everywhere. Okay, they're not ready. I'm happy if I get ITS. Okay, good. It's time to keep going. Nicely. Oh, look, you got the S touching the line. Can you make the T and the I touch the line for me? Good girl. All the way down to the line. Good girl, Catherine. Now you're finished with that sentence, so what are you going to put? Now I want you to write something the teacher said at the end of the story. So you're going to say, the teacher said... I love the way you're rereading your sentences. Okay, and your S, can you put your S down on the line for me? Just like your other S? Good job. You know that one. Good for you. Look at that, Catherine. All those words touch the line. Good job. Okay, so are you finished with that sentence? Now I want you to tell me, oh, let me show you. The period goes on the line, too. Can you put the period on the line, too? Good. Now I want you to write, the teacher said, and think of something she said at the end of the story. Okay? Okay, Drew, that's fine. Let's see how you're doing, bud. You looking on time? You're finished with that sentence, so what are you going to put? There, nice. Now I want you to write what the teacher said at the end of the story. The teacher said... Okay, let's look at the word for. Check it and see if there's something you want to fix. There you go. Now let's look at the word recess. You're missing something. No, don't erase it. You're missing something right here. Excellent. So now what do you put at the end? Can you make that a little bit deeper so I can see? Good. Now write something the teacher said at the end of the story. The teacher said, good job. She said, Catherine? Look and think about the last page, remember? Near the children standing. And they're standing at the door. Right? Remember the last page? They're standing here at the door. Okay. And what do you think the teacher was saying then?
Let's go outside.
Let's go outside or let's go back inside?
Let's go back inside.
There you go. She said, let's go inside. Okay. What you working on, honey? The? Oh, let's see. It's time for recess. You already got that, darling. Now we're going to write the teacher said. And you're going to write something, Patrick, that the teacher said at the end of the story. Okay? All the way down to the line. Tell me why you're erasing that tweet. Why are you erasing that?
Because it doesn't look right.
What do you need to do for it? Tell me, would you make the D longer? You can just take your pencil. You don't have to erase it. Side. That's right. Just put your D higher. You need your stick higher. You don't need to erase it. You need to look up. See how what a nice job you did on this one? That's all you need. Okay, are you finished? So what I want you to do is I want you to go up here and I want you to write the word said 3 times, okay? You're going to go write the word said 3 times. Okay. So inside. Okay. Write said 3 times. Okay. Oh, you're remembering to put that on the line, Patrick. I'm so proud of you. Yeah. It's okay. Next letter in set. One more letter. And we're going to stop right there today. Okay, Patrick? All right, boys and girls, here's what I want you to do. I want you to check to see if your period is on the line. Okay? You want your period on the line. Go to check to see if your period is on the line. If it isn't, make sure it's on the line. Good job. And they all have capital letters at the beginning of their sentences. That is awesome. Okay, I want you to do one more thing for me. I want you to find the 2 letters that say ch and circle them. You should find it twice. I always do a teaching point at the end of the writing. Sometimes it's punctuation, capitalization. Sometimes it's letter formation. But they're actually, I was wondering about the go, if they would know that it goes below the line. They're doing a great job on that. Okay, you're all finished. Go ahead and put your pencil back. So what 2 letters say ch?
C-H.
And spell said for me. What's the first letter?
S-A-I-D.
You're fabulous. Okay, you guys can go back to class. Thank you. Time for questions, observations. Something you noticed or something you're wondering about.
Do you have I noticed you were using like a plain sheet of paper as your documentation for your assessment. Mm-hmm. Do you have any like recommendations on that?
Well, and I use this mostly because it's just for today. You know, if I were you, I would have something that would have like a daily, like a weekly chart that would have the kids grouped. And what are my observations on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday? So that you would have, are you noticing different changes across time? It's a little bit hard to get that idea from here. So if I were to do something, you could even do something like this, you see, that has the kids' names, this is the next group, and this is the next group. And then you wouldn't even need the level here. You could make these categories, whatever fits the level. So if you're thinking about what I want to check off, if I look at my appendix, go ahead and go back to Appendix D. And I actually have these monitoring sheets. Did I give you guys these sheets? I think I did one. Did I give you like one for each level and it had these indicators across the top? That's what I would use. And then if I'm thinking about, because they're at a D right now, maintaining meaning while problem solving new words. Okay, so that's on page 277. All right, they're not doing that yet. Okay, like line, they all had trouble with line, so they weren't maintaining meaning while they were problem solving consistently. I'm sure like snow pants, mittens, hats, those kinds of things they were doing well. But it's not firm yet. That's okay. Because you see it says students learn too. So these are indicators that I would expect them to do before I move into the next level. Cross-check without prompting. When I think about that, cross-check without prompting is when they say one thing, and it either it doesn't make sense or it doesn't match the first letters, and they self-correct. Now, on the with Catherine, she said R for ran, and she fixed it. She said hair for hat, and she fixed it. But she was the only one that I saw cross-check today. But it's not just my observations in guided reading. It's also what you're seeing on their running record as well. So, you know, sometimes you don't capture that one little piece. And we noticed, I'm trying to think, Peggy, are they self-correcting? Where did she go?
She took her kids back.
I don't remember if they are, but I think they were. I think that might be her. Yay, Peggy! we were just talking about their cross-checking. We didn't see evidence of it today as much. Mm-hmm. We saw it in Catherine. When you were looking at the running record, did you see them self-correcting errors?
Well, the running record showed me on level 6, they just tried to make meaning, but they couldn't figure out the words. Like, this is the book, why are we stopping? Mm-hmm. They got to, both of them got to stopped, and they just could not figure out the meaning. So they couldn't really.
And see, that's a much harder word to figure out. Stop is kind of like line. I mean, you know, it's not like hats and gloves, mittens and coats.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, stop is even a verb. So it's a little bit different than.
And then stopped.
Yeah, and the ending, we knew that the endings weren't strong for them. Now, when I looked in this book, I didn't, and maybe I should have looked a little harder. I didn't see any EDs. I only saw S's. So the next book I would look for them would be a book that has some EDs in it. So I could, and ING, because that's a focus on at this level. In fact, it's the bullet 4, attend to endings in reading and writing with prompting. So I want to, when I'm selecting text, and that's my focus, I want to make sure. I think this was a great choice for today, perfect choice, for our purpose, which was to get them to take risks and to check through the word. And they did a nice job of checking through the word. It was the middle of the word that they weren't always checking. So that'll be the next. Remember, I told you that progression. That'll be the next thing. Use known parts with prompting. Those would be words like inside, into, behind. They didn't get behind, I don't think, on why you're stopping. So we know they're not always looking for parts. But there really, again, wasn't the opportunity to have them do that. So my next book, I'm going to look for that as well. Blend sounds in small words. I think they're good at that. Don't you think so? They can figure. They figured out let's. You know, I heard them go through the word for lots, so that was very good. Reread to access meaning. Didn't see a lot of that without prompting. I actually emphasized it for Drew, and that was one of my notes that I made. So if I had, you know, if I had this on a chart, that would pretty much be an open bullet, and I'd say, gosh, that's something I need to be focusing on, making sure they're doing that. Read without pointing. They all want to use their finger, and this is when you say, no, you can't do it anymore. Why?
Slow down.
Okay. The reason why do we have them put their fingers in the books?
One-to-one matching.
When they have one-to-one match, so I usually get rid of it about 3 or 4. You see, it's already gone on almost so long that it's become ingrained, and it's hard for us to let it go because there's like this this comfort we get. When we're working over here and we're kind of glancing over there and we see them using their finger, we get this comfort that, well, I know they're reading. So it's hard for us to get rid of that. But, you know, there's an element of trust in guided reading, and we have to get rid of that finger for that. Read in short phrases. I definitely want to work on fluency, but it wouldn't be the first day for this group because this was definitely an instructional text. I think it was just right for them. They had to do just enough work. But tomorrow, we are definitely going to work on reading more fluent. And we did work a little bit on expression with her, and I saw a little shift with the exclamation point on the second time I read with her. This one's already reading with expression, but she's not putting words together. For the most part, it was word-by-word reading. Okay, that's okay. At level 6, that's telling me that they're looking at print, but see, they've been using their finger. So that's why it's word-by-word. What they're almost doing now is pointing with their eyes. You know, and sometimes you'll see the head bobbing as well. Read and write about 40 words. That again, it's the writing that's the challenge in kindergarten, making sure they're building that visual memory. You could see two of them are stronger than the others in that. And it's just something you want to focus on. It really is. It's important because you are building strong spellers because you're building the process. So it's not really about teaching them to spell. In fact, I discontinue it at the early level. Once they have 50 to 60 sight words, I don't do that sight word review anymore because it's not about spelling. It's about teaching them how to remember. And teaching them to sequentially, that's the other thing, sequentially remember. See, if they're running set S-E-D, that tells me they're not even thinking about what the word looks like. And yet they had no trouble reading it in the book. See, they're not crossing the visual and the phonemic awareness. And you want those neurons to be crossing in the brain. Digraphs and short vowels in reading and writing, they definitely have that. They're going, all of them got teacher today, so I was really happy. Now, in the word work, he was just a little bit weak on it. He wanted to put in the SH as well, and yet, or maybe the SH was over here. One of them, it was over here. But I saw evidence of it. Now, tomorrow, the next time I do a dictated sentence, I'm probably going to hope to get that shh in there as well. Okay. And then attend to both, that's read dialogue with expression, something we're working on. Hear and record sounds in sequence without support. They already have mastered that. So we can check that one off. Retell the story and respond to questions with support. Okay, I got the story a little out of sequence, so it's okay if they did too. And it's just kind of a, you know, thing like that. Okay, other questions?
You don't do nonsense words when making words?
Occasionally I do. Is that part of your assessment? I wouldn't do it then, unless it's part of the assessment. It doesn't make sense. I mean, you know.
Right, that's right.
I was watching a teacher do it, and she was doing nonsense words, and he looked up at her and he said, I bet they're making you do that. Because he realized he wouldn't make me read something that doesn't make sense. So,
with the sight words, so a couple of them misspelled said in the dictated writing. So tomorrow.
Oh, did they?
I thought one did and fixed it.
Well, if I didn't attend to it, it was my mistake.
No, I would think
you did. It was Drew and
he
does it
inside.
ED.
Yeah, it was only Drew. And everybody else wrote said correctly. But the second time Drew wrote it, he did write it. And I waited until Drew?
Yeah,
you're right. It was Drew. And he wrote it well the second time, so he didn't mess it up.
But I guess my question is, tomorrow when you're doing sight words, do you redo said?
Yes.
And do you redo said even if everybody had spelled
yes.
it correctly? So you do it 2 days,
2 days
with the mix it, fix it, and
mix
everything.
Mix it and fix it. Yeah.
And so in the three words they write at the beginning, is said one of them?
Yes, it would be.
And
that's kind of like my assessment to see if I needed to prompt. And I think tomorrow, when you say write said, I'll probably have to whisper to Drew, and what's the second letter?
Mm-hmm.
And if he says E, it's not an E, and then he'll get it. Now, he may look in this cup,
mm-hmm.
and that's okay.
Mm-hmm.
That's a scaffold for him. And then that word said is going to stay up here in the review. It's going to be one of the review words for like three times, plus I'm going to keep it in my dictated sentence
mm-hmm.
for several times. And then I would expect the transfer into Writer's Workshop. And if they write said wrong in Writer's Workshop, you don't let it go because it's something that you've taught. And let me just give you a tip. I know these children are the higher level readers, but just yesterday I was working with some A's at this time of year. If your children, do you have any level ones in kindergarten? Okay. If you have ones now, they are very different than these children when they were ones. Okay. Their problem is visual memory and phonemic awareness. I mean, one of the reasons why they didn't take off right away is because the phonemic awareness and visual memory wasn't there. So what I'm finding is that you're going to have to stay in that same sight word maybe 4 days. Now, once they get to level B, it usually kicks in and 2 days is going to be enough. But and the biggest mistake I see teachers make is they just plod along, introduce new words every 2 days, and the kids don't have any of them. And then they start to ask them to write them, and they're so confused. And when that happens, I say, okay, stop, go back and reassess them. Can they write, do a quick write in your lesson on the level A words, and then put a plus if they get them right. And then if they don't get them right, don't put anything on your chart. You know, I'm talking about that word chart. And then go back and reteach those words one by one, slowly. Now, those words are mostly phonetic, so if they're hearing sounds, they should be okay with that. And then your non-phonetic sight words really don't... You have like and look and the. Those are about the only three that you have at the A and the B level. And then you get into the come here set at the C level.
Jen, what kind of notes are you making as you're listening to them read? I don't know how detailed we need to be.
Yes. I prompted him for meaning, and I put a teaching point because, and I should have written down what it was that the students were putting on that he didn't. Maybe it was snow pants or coats. It was something that was right in the picture, and he got stuck on the word. And I said, you know, check the picture, and he got it, but I had to prompt him to use his meaning. And then he said, run for ran, but I didn't fix it. I didn't address it because he had so much trouble with the other. I didn't want to attend to too many, you know, errors. Over was tricky for him. Oh, that's what the page he was on, is when the page that had the word over for him. And I said, get your mouth ready. And he got the O, and then he started to go, oh, it was the very last, because he was the last one I got to, so it was here. Said the teacher, that's what it was. He said, oh, no, said the time. Yeah. So it didn't make sense, and I said, think about your story. What would make sense? And then he went back and he fixed it. And then he had trouble with recess. Mm-hmm. I said, think about where they're going. And then so I had to keep prompting for the meaning of the story. What's happening is he's looking too much at the letters, and he's not thinking about that. And that, it's like the difference between driving in third gear and driving in first gear. You know, when they're in third gear, they're thinking about the meaning and the visual, and it's moving along just well. He's way down here thinking about just the letters. And then when he got to over, he didn't know what to do with that one. And so I said, get your mouth ready, say the first part. He said, oh. And I said, say a little more. He went, ov. But that's as far as he got. And I said, think about the story. Go back and reread again. And then he got over. So that's telling me. Now, I also thought about attending to the ER as a chunk. But actually, she got it in teacher. I think she was the only one who got the ER.
No, he did.
Oh, yes, Patrick got the ER.
And that's why I was wondering, did you guys teach the boss ER?
We've been doing it, yeah.
Because they were on diagraph, they got their blends, they got the endings. And I'm like, the capital letter. And so I have 6 8s in first grade, and
They're impulsive.
It's also
the
brains.
Actually, we're going to see that next because they're different learners. It's so easy for them.
And then I think like...
But that's because they're above grade.
I know. But I think Ben and... They're not putting it all together. Andy, and it's
you
like...
You could have
the
taught
teacher.
Your kids the ER last year, and they wouldn't have gotten
it.
You know what I mean? They would not have
retained. They're just not putting it all together. They're good at, like, if my teaching point was ING today or said, they're all good. And then, like, to go back and teach her, I can tell you that the group I'm thinking of would totally forget the CH.
But we did just talk about it.
And they're impulsive writers. And these kids were the most careful
little
writers at that I've ever seen for a kid.
It'll be good for us to compare when we get the next group. But I want to go back to your question because, you know, when you have these children that are the 6s and 8s right now, how much of your whole group teaching are they getting?
Right.
Very little. Because your other kids are up there, and so you're talking about the silent E, and they're like, gosh, you know, I thought the E said, now the E is silent. And even if they are listening, they don't get it.
They start putting E's on every word that they say.
And you're probably not even addressing the CH in class anymore because everybody else has it. So you just want to make sure you address it in your guided reading, and that's why I have that appendix at the end. To help you know when they're at a 6, these are the skills they need to be working on, and let the other things go. In other words, let the EA go. Let the OW go. Don't worry about the vowel patterns. Worry about just this part. And the ER is actually something that I don't even introduce at this level. It's really at the next level. And some of them have it, some of them don't, but they're very visual as well. And your kids that are at 6 8s were not visual. Now, here's interesting. When we start to look at the next group, they were not visual in the beginning. I'll tell you right now, they were just kind of didn't look at words. We've had focus so much on the visual. Sometimes they're struggling kids now up to 6 8. That's all they're doing is looking at the words, and they're not using the meaning. So it's getting them to mix both of those things together.
Right.
So there's nothing wrong with your children at all. It's that they're different when they're this level in kindergarten and that level in first grade. But they actually are learning the same skills.
It's in there. It's just, it's so hard to get back.
And you know what the secret is? It's the sentence. It's making sure you do that guided writing so that your expectations, see that, we crafted that sentence very carefully because I wanted to make sure said was in there, I wanted to make sure the ch was in there, I wanted to see what they would do with phonetically words that they don't know how to spell. Nobody asked me how to spell something. And what you have taught in word study, you make sure is in the sentence. And that's your opportunity to do a little more scaffolding.
Come. 3 out of 4 couldn't spell. How would you handle that?
Yes. Tomorrow, I need a new word. Well, we'll do come. Or the next time. Like tomorrow, we'd do set again because I would do 2 days on set, and then we would come back and we would do come. So when you see those words, the sight words at level C, I don't really teach the ones at level D until they have the ones at level C. Like we thought about teaching they today. But and that the level, the 82 has the level C words, and there's it's also in the early section. I don't have they here. The reason I don't have it is it's not really a common word at most level 6 books. You really see it more at level 8.
What page is that?
And that's on page, this is on page 82. So make sure they have these words. These are the more common words at this level. So I went and looked, I looked at a lot of texts, and I identified what were the most common sight words at that level. That's how I got that.
I have a question about sight words. What kind of value do you put on just having them read the sight words? And I know you think it's very important that they learn how to write the sight words, but what about the reading of the sight words?
Yes.
Just giving them a...
Right.
So that's a good thing
to
do.
That's fine, too. Yeah. I don't do it in my lesson,
right?
Because what I have found is if we have worked on writing the sight words, they can read them. So I don't have to do the flashcards at all in the lesson.
But
it frees me up. But it's fine to do it in a, like a center, you know, the kids can play bingo at a center, but I never do that as a word work at the table.
Mm-hmm.
Something you could send home.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Why? Let's talk about why. Because I really want them to read the words in connected text. And I have too many kids that I've come across who can read it on the card, and then they're not really reading it in the text. I haven't really found a lot of value in that, although it's part of a reading recovery, you know, my pile, your pile, it's definitely part of that.
Right.
Questions on this group?
I actually do have a question, and it the only reason I'm even asking it is because a big deal is made out of it in reading recovery. When you break the words, I noticed you were having them move at to the right.
Yes.
And in reading recovery, we move CH to the left.
Yes.
And it's to be in the line of vision as they work.
Yeah. Sorry. I'm going to just tell you why I do it. Because
okay.
I developed my technique before reading recovery changed things.
I know. It's a revised version.
I don't let them take away every letter. I want them to break. I don't let them break wherever they want to. They have to break at the onset and the rhyme. But I even have them, they can just break it like this.
Okay.
They don't have to necessarily. I say start with the I and go that way, which hopefully if they do that, then the CH is actually in the line of vision.
Because
if they make it, the CH, and then they move that up there. So that would be the first thing they see. So it should work that way. Okay. So that's a good question. I mean, who am I to argue with Marie Claire? Never argue with Marie Claire. My book had already been in the publishing phase. I'm not going to change it. And it hasn't hurt. Because really, you know, in a situation like reading recovery kids, and they're extremely, my purpose is to get them to see the chunks. And see, I think that word work, the ch, at really helped them firm up the ch sound. And they didn't have any problems.
So you just break it for that glued sound, like and. At
right.
am, because it's really a glued sound. You don't want them really segmenting, because it's not. It's a glued
right.
sound.
It's ch at. So
right.
once they get to the blends, digraphs and blends is when I start to break them.
Mm-hmm.
So if we're working on the blends, like we go from spot to spit to spin, I would have them break every one and go sp in, because that's how I want them to read. So I'm trying to teach them how to. So when they get stuck on a word in reading, I can say, "Can you break that word?" And they'll know what I mean. Because they've done it in isolated word work.
And the last question, and on the making words at this level, you did 2 vowels. Do you normally, that's all, you just do the 2 vowels
yes,
at one time?
Yeah, I just
before.
Took a sequence, or actually Peggy just took a sequence out of my appendix. Yeah, and I don't do all the vowels at one time, because it makes too many letters.
No,
up there.
I will never.
Yeah.
And I guess my only concern about the way that it's, that moving that over is, I know you're saying this is in the line of vision, but their focus of attention when they're moving that over is the end of the word. And from my point of view, the focus of their attention should be on the first part first and then the end of the
right.
word. And that's just...
And I haven't seen it as a problem. But gosh, you know, go ahead and do it. Do it the way it's working for your reading recovery kids. I've never, you know, by breaking those words like that, I've never seen the children tend to at the end last first.
Okay.
Never. It's never been an issue.
Okay.
Because I make them take their finger, and I say, you know, I teach them to say the first part, say the last part, and they get to that left, right.
Okay.
So I have Kevin, Tommy, and Jalen here. They've all three been through reading recovery. They're coming to the end of the reading recovery time, and they've, you know, they've made some nice progress. Kevin actually, just this week, his DRAs are a lot better than, you know, he was a 10 independent and a 12 instructional, whereas Tommy and Jalen are 6-8. We are going to read a 10, because they are working in 10s also, so, because a lot of them, you know, they might be in instructional at 8 and instructional at 10, and just...
Well, and also, like you mentioned this morning, your books aren't, you know, all uniform in their levels. So this is,
so,
I think this is an easy
test. Yeah, that's what we were looking for, was a 10 that was accessible for them. They're doing some monitoring for meeting, but not always. Especially Cap, Tommy, and Jalen, it will break down. They're looking more at visual. I think they're more at what you were talking about sometimes in first year.
Yeah.
Not always, though. They are definitely self-correcting more than they were, obviously, at the beginning of the year, and doing more and more of it. But I think also, as they work through a hard text and they get towards the end of it, and they've done it for a long time, I think they just become fatigued. It gets, you can see it sort of breaking down, and they're just trying to get through the sentence and, you know, in the DRA.
And hopefully you won't stop them.
Yeah.
So,
I think we're going to look at that, like decoding and attending to text and making sure that they're really paying attention. And what else did we say?
Retell.
And doing retelling. They're actually not doing too badly with retelling. They needed a lot of prompting as the DRAs. Two of them are ESOL students. As the DRAs went on, I'm just concerned that the retelling is just going to get harder and harder as the texts become more complicated. So.
And Jalen has...
Yes, she does.
Mm-hmm. Right. And sometimes, we mentioned this morning, I don't know if it was Phyllis, but with your ESOL children, when you take the DRA and you say, now tell me about the story,
mm-hmm.
well, they might not have a language to be able to tell you about the story. So
yeah, we gave a lot. Kevin specifically responded well to a lot of prompting at the beginning. But someone's like, once he got going, you know, he did a really nice
job. One thing I will do with your ESOL kids, and it helps them with their language, is when I'm prompting, when I'm working with them, for example, on this page, I will then stop and say, now tell me,
mm-hmm.
what did you read? And use your picture to help you, because
mm-hmm.
this is a very supportive text.
Mm-hmm.
When you are working on retelling, the process is not remembering the words, actually.
Mm-hmm.
You don't remember the words. You remember pictures.
Mm-hmm.
And when you get into books where there are no pictures, you
mm-hmm.
create pictures.
Yeah.
So that visualization
mm-hmm.
is, I mean, the first level of comprehension is really monitoring.
Mm-hmm.
Does it make sense? But the second level is, do I create pictures in my head, or do I remember the pictures that
mm-hmm.
I read? That's why it's so important that we use these books with pictures, and with your ESOL children, it's the way they're going to gain vocabulary
I think it's one of the weaknesses of some of our DRA texts. Some of the pictures in some of those DRAs are just like, even I don't know what that
mm-hmm.
dog was just
misleading.
Like,
you
know,
yeah.
So, you know, we give them this support,
mm-hmm.
and that's great, and then sometimes we give them an assessment that the picture support is not nearly what the picture support in that. But, you know, when they get to be a 10 or 12, we want to see, are they, because some kids are telling you a story that you know they got strictly from the picture.
Right.
So,
and of course, Joetta Beeble would say the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
This is one assessment on
mm-hmm.
one day, and that you have to look at that child
mm-hmm.
And I even asked Phyllis, this is what what the DRA said, but, you know, what are you seeing mostly with the children? Their fluency was...
Jalen's is probably the weakest of
mm-hmm.
the three. Kevin's was really good. And Tommy says, I think, you know, tell me what you think. I think it's good when he's going, but then when he's starting to fix things up, obviously it breaks down. And he'll go back a lot, which is good. He'll go back to self-correct, but
I do not expect this book to be fluent
mm-hmm.
for them
right.
on the first
mm-hmm. I wouldn't either.
Because there's going to be probably a lot of problem solving
mm-hmm.
they're going to
mm-hmm.
have to do.
Mm-hmm.
We are still working on sight words now. Sometimes when you have your children at 10s, 12s, you don't need sight words anymore, because you just look at their writing and they've written all those words. They've got that visual memory in place. You can let it go. These children are still working on that visual memory. And for our teaching focus, we're actually going to look at taking words apart, finding parts in words. And this one has a lot of compound words in there. So it's a great
mm-hmm.
book for that strategy. And the sight word we're going to do is four, because Phyllis identified that's one that they're having trouble with. And then we're actually going to do the same word study as far as the tat and chat and chat mm-hmm. that we did for the other kids, because they're, you know, they mm-hmm. really needed that as well. So this is not unusual. They're reading a 10, right?
Mm-hmm.
But they're working at the word work
mm-hmm.
at a 6.
Oh, yeah.
That's not unusual for your struggling kids as well.
Mm-hmm.
And it's okay to do that way. Okay, we're ready for it. Good morning.
Good morning. I didn't hear anybody say good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
We have Jalen, and we have, you must be Kevin. And we have Tommy. Wonderful. Okay. Go ahead and take your markers out and get started. I meant to ask for a timer before. Does anybody have a timer in this room? You know what? Would you mind just passing me my purse? Because I can grab one.
Yeah.
Oh. I can use my iPhone, so I can use it. I just have to see what the time is, or else I just know I spend too much time and it's not paced right. And I want them to see the pacing as well.
I'll get time next time.
I'm just going to set it for 20. Because that would be the first part of the lesson, but then, of course, the writing would actually be done on day two. Okay, boys and girls, I want you to write the word went. It's got four letters in it, went. Think of what it looks like. Say it as you write it.
Went.
Beautiful. Race, erase, erase. Excellent. Down. I love how fast they're writing it. Write the word down. Say it as you write it. Down. It's going to be a D. That's right, the ow sound. You remember the ow sound? Like in cow? O-W. You just prompt them, you know, you don't teach, you just, good, excellent. What's that word?
Down.
Underline the part that says ow. Two letters. What says ow? Good job, erase. And the last one is with. Look at my mouth. With. Okay?
Yeah.
Say it as you write it.
With.
Good job, Jalen. If. Okay, that one I would circle, and we would go back and work on that one again. They're having trouble with that one. Okay, you got it. Very good. So when I'm saying this word, watch me. I go whoa. If. Right. Okay. Erase. All right. Put your markers back in your basket. We're going to read a great story. You're going to love the story. It's about a mischievous cat. And mischievous means he's getting into trouble all the time. You're going to read about Oliver and how. What are some of the naughty things he does. You can see a naughty thing he does just on the cover. What is he doing on the cover that's naughty?
He spilled
the powder. That's called powder. Okay. Now, because two of these are still in English as a second language, I'm going to do a richer book introduction than I did with the last one. Okay? Let's look on the page two. Ooh. You see what she did on page two? Cats shouldn't be doing that. Do you see where she's standing on the...
On table.
She's, it could be a table or a counter. Okay?
Counter.
Can you find the word counter on page two? Counter.
Counter.
She's on the counter. That's kitchen. Yes, counter. Very good. Okay, now let's look at the next. Oh, and what did she do on that counter?
He spilled some jelly.
Yes, it could be jelly or jam. Okay, it's the same thing. And look at this. The jam went everywhere. Boys and girls, I want to show you that word. Because you're going to see that word on a lot of pages. It's a great big word, and we can break it up into the first part says every, and this part says where. So this word is everywhere. Find that word. That one, she made such a mess. Okay, let's see what Oliver does next. Can you tell what room Oliver is in now? She's not in the kitchen anymore, is she? Could she be in the living room? What do you think?
He spilled some flour.
Oh, let's go on this page. We skipped the page. You're right. She's in the living room now. And look where she jumped up. Do you see? That's called a window sill. Boys and girls, when you have a window, the part that's right here, if this were the window, this is called a window sill. And there was something on the window sill. Do you see what's on the window sill?
A
flower. Turn the page. Oh, what did she do, Tommy?
She tore the flowers.
Very good. It fell off, didn't it? Look at that mess. Now, can you tell where she's going to go next? Look at her footprints on page 7. Do you think where she's going? Ah, she's going to the bedroom. You think she's going to scratch it? What a great prediction. Oh, what is she on top of now? Do you know what might be in the bedroom that has this? Where you, it's drawer or dresser where you put your clothes. You put them in the dresser. Turn the page. And you can, you know what she did on here. What did she knock off again? What is this called?
Powder.
Powder, like you put them on babies. Okay, turn the page. Well, she has been so busy. Now what is she doing? She is sleeping. Very good. Okay. Yep, that's right. That's the word nap. Okay, start to read. And if you finish reading, what should you do? Read it again. Okay. Yep, read that. Mm-hmm. Mess. I'll make some mess. He jumped up on the kitchen. Check your picture. Remember what this is called in the kitchen? It's a counter. Mm-hmm. Okay. What's tricking you, children? That word? Okay, let's read this part. Okay. Can you say the first part? Good girl. You see what you did, Joey? At this group? Is you sounded the first part? What was that part again? And this part says ash. And that helped you. So do that on the next time, okay? Alright, let's go back and read again and think it would make sense. Sound the first part. Did you do it? Good job. Okay, let's go back to everywhere. Show me the part that says every. Good. Show me your fingers like that. Okay? That says every. And what's the next part?
Where?
Yes. Good. Show me the first part of that word. Mm-hmm. What does that first part say? And what's this? Bed? See? Look. Bed. And this part says? Good. Keep going. I like what you're doing. Remember what this could be in the bedroom? Why don't you try covering the ending and see if that helps you? Cover the ending, darling. Take your finger. Let me show you. I'm going to help you. You're going to do a good job. Cover the ER, okay? Now, see if that helps you. Got the dr. Could it be dresser or dresser? What do you think? Dresser. A dresser is where you put clothes in the drawer. Okay?
The
Let's go back to this one. It fell off the dressing. Check your ending, Jay. Could it be dressing? What could it be? Dress what? Yeah. Look at, show me the part that says in dresser. Beautiful. Now read that again. Are you right? Girls, you want to make sure you look at your ending. Keep going.
Yes.
This is called a...
counter.
Is there a tricky page, Kevin, that you like to show me in the book? It's part of the page for you. That, this page right here? Let's go back to this page and have you do this page.
The flower plant found in the crash onto the floor.
Crash.
Are you right? Did you think it's dirt? Yeah, you're right, Violin. Darling, keep going. What do you think? Powder or power? What do you think?
Powder.
Okay, boys and girls, I'm gonna stop you. What wonderful work you did. I'm so proud of you, all three of you. Excellent. Please turn to page 6. I want to teach you something today. When you come across real big words, it's a good idea to try to break them into parts. Now, we talked about this a little bit before. Okay, so this is called
bedroom.
And it's called a compound word because it has two parts. What's the first part?
Bed.
What's the second part?
Room.
Now, on page 6, I want to see if you can find a compound word. Point to a word that has two words in it. Oh, very good. Which one did you find?
Flower pot.
Flower pot. What's the first part?
Flower.
And what's the second part?
Pot.
Can you find another one, Jalen? Good. What's the first part?
Window.
And the second part?
Sill.
Good. Can you find one more? There's one more. There it is.
Where?
And what's the first part?
Every.
And the last part?
Where.
Excellent. Okay. Now, there's only one other thing I wanted to talk about today. There were a couple words that ended in this chunk right here. The ER says er. So this one, he jumped on the
counter.
This one, he jumped on the dresser. Dresser. And this one he knocked over the
powder.
Excellent. So whenever you see that ER, you know it's going to say er. Okay. Why do you think he jumped on the windowsill? Let's go back to that page. When he jumped on the windowsill. Let's find that page. Page 5. Why do you think Oliver jumped on the windowsill? Thumbs up if you have an idea. One idea? Who else has an idea? You have an idea? Do you have an idea why he jumped on the windowsill? What do you think, Kevin? That's good. You can talk about that.
Off.
They have the flower pot. Mm-hmm. Okay, so they have a flower pot in the windowsill. Do you think he might like flowers?
No.
No? So why do you think he jumped on the windowsill? Oh, he just wants to be mean and mischievous. Okay. What are you thinking, Jalen? Why did he jump up on that windowsill? Any ideas?
Maybe he wants to be flowers.
Maybe he thought it was something to eat. Now, do any of you have a cat?
No.
Have you ever been to a house with a cat?
No. I just live in an apartment.
An apartment.
When I get a pet in an apartment, okay. I just use too much money.
Okay. Well, let me tell you something. Cats like to jump on the windowsill because they like to look out. Pets like to look outside the window. And boy, that flower pot just happened to be in the wrong place. Do you think they cared if he knocked over the flower pot?
No.
Why not? He makes a mess everywhere, so they're going to get used to him knocking over the flower pot, right? Okay, well, that's a good inference. Okay. Well, I'm just, you know what I was thinking? Let me tell you what I was thinking. gosh, look at all this dirt that I'm going to have to, you see, is Oliver going to clean up that dirt? No, who's going to clean up that dirt? Mom is, and I would say, out with the cat. That's what I would say. Okay, let's look at this word, okay? This is a good word for you guys to learn. The word is four, very good, and it has this chunk in it. What's that part?
Four.
Okay, let's play the game, what's missing. Are you ready? What's missing? Oops. What's missing?
Oh.
Oh, this is easy for you. What's missing, Kevin?
F-O.
Okay. Tommy, spell the word four.
F-O-R.
Good. Take your letters in this cup and make the word four.
Mix and fix.
Yes, mix and fix.
Good job.
Four. Excellent. Okay, put him back in the cup.
Four.
You know what to do now? Table right. Okay, say the word four and write it with your finger. Say four. Say the word four. Good. Now write it with your marker. Say it. Let me show you the F looks like that. Very beautiful. Wow. And what part says or?
O-R.
Beautiful. Okay, erase. Put your things in your cup, in your basket. Now, I want you to take the letters in your cup. I want you to dump them out, and I want you to line them up on the table. See, you can do it first. Go. Line them up on the table, Tom. And you have a P there. Can you change that to a P? Oh, very good. You guys are fast. Not making words, darling. Just lining up the letters. Where's your rest of your letters? Oh, no, those aren't your letters. Stop. Something happened and we lost some letters here. So we're going to give you what's in this cup. Okay? You lost some letters. That's okay, though. We got another cup for you. Quick, quick. Okay. Take three letters and make it say hat. Oh, I love the way you're saying it slowly. What good teachers you have. Check your A. Check your A. Where's the sticker go? Oh, there you go. Okay. Now, check it with your finger. Hat. Add a letter to make it say chat. You need four letters. Very good. Break it. Do you know how to break it? Yes, you do. Good. I'm going to put this up here. When you break it, you're going to take the vowel and you're going to put it like that, okay? Now, good, make it.
Chat.
Change a letter to make it say chap. Check it first. Check it first. Okay, wait a second. Okay, before you reach for that P, you need to check it with your finger. Say chap. No, chap.
Chap.
There you go. Which one are you going to change? Good, break it. Say it. Make it. Boy, you can get your letters, lessons done in 20 minutes with this group. No trouble. Okay, change a word, change a letter to make it say chip. Check it first. Chip. Yes. Okay. Nice job. Just four letters, so you need to take one of those away. Check it with your finger. Say chip. Chip. What letter do you take away? Okay, do you hear a puff? Chip. Yeah, do you hear a ah? That's what you take away. Okay, before you reach, they're a little impulsive. I know you didn't know that. But before you reach for a letter, boys and girls, you need to make sure you take the letter away, okay? Change one letter to make it say ship. Great. Break it and say it. And make it. And what's that word?
Ship.
Excellent. 18 minutes flat. Okay? Put your letters in your cup. You did a super job. Okay, now tomorrow, of course, you would go over the word four. It would be one of your three. And then you would probably do with again, because that was one that was a little tricky for them. The other ones they did well. And then you'd pull something else from your list that they've done before. They would reread. What's really important about that second day is they reread this book and other familiar books. It's real important. And they should read for about 8 minutes. I look at my clock, and when I have about 10 minutes left, I stop the reading. They might read 3, 4, 5 books. They need that massive amount of reading with teacher prompting. They need the reading in this, you know, individually too, but you have to be there as well. But now we get to write. So go ahead and take your pencils. Jalen and Tommy. And go ahead and turn to your next blank page. Wow, look at all the beautiful writing that you're doing. I am so impressed with your writing. Today you're going to be writing one thing that the cat did at the beginning of the story, something the cat did in the middle, and something the cat did at the end. So I want you to think about your pictures, okay? What was the picture that happened at the beginning of the story, Jalen? What did the cat do?
Oliver jumped up on the counter.
Jumped up on the counter. That would be something you could write. What else happened at the beginning? Do you remember what he did when he jumped up on the counter?
He spilled the jelly.
So you could say Oliver spilled the jelly or the jam. And what might you
jam,
say?
Jam, jam.
Start writing. Oliver.
Oliver spilled the flower pot.
Not yet. That's going to come next. We can do about the counter. You could say Oliver jumped.
Jumped up
on the counter and spilled the
flower pot.
Now on the counter. Remember on the counter? What did he spill on the counter? Remember that?
Jelly.
The jelly. Okay, go. Start writing. That's 20 minutes. I'm on day 2 anyway, so it doesn't matter. Okay, tell me your sentence again. We're going to start with Oliver, okay? Go. Start with Oliver. Good. And now we want spilled. Do you know what the two letters at the end of that word to make it say spilled? There's two letters. Let me show you.
E-D.
E-D. You got it. Okay. Remember the er chunk? The two letters that say er? R is one of them, but what goes in here? There you go. Say Oliver. Oliver.
Oliver.
Okay, what's the next sound? Oh. There you go. Good. Can you tell me Oliver spilled the jam on the counter? Can you make that a little bit longer for me? On the counter. Excellent. You told me Oliver jumped on the counter. You told me Oliver jumped up on the counter. Okay. Ver. How are you going to write ver? Okay, two letters that say er. Remember? Er. There you go. And what noisy writing they are. Good job. Counter. Okay, let's try counter. What were you going to write here? He spilled on the ground. Oh, okay. Keep going. You're okay. Spilled the jam on the ground. Yeah, that's fine. Was he on the ground? Let's go back to that. I'm just going to think about that. Did he spill the jam on the ground? Can we check and see and make sure? Yes, he did. Okay. You're okay. Jumped. Two letters. Not a T. Good job. Okay. Ground. Wow. Okay, wait for the end. You're going to put it in your sentence. It goes right there. Mm-hmm. Now let me look at Oliver, okay? What are the two letters that say er? Remember? There's an R, but what comes before the R? That says er. E-R. Not A. E. Over. Okay? Now you're going to write, what did Oliver do in the middle? Oliver. Good. Oliver went to the living room. Good. Tell me your sentence again. Oliver. I want you to write, Oliver went to the living room. Okay, E-D. Good. On the counter, so we can put the end in there. Good. Period. No? Okay. Just a period. Okay, what was something he did in the middle of the story? What did Oliver do? What did he spell? In the middle. Spilled the jam in the beginning. Think of a picture that happened in the middle of the story. What did he spill in the middle? Think about the... What other pictures do you remember in the story, Jan? He spilled the jam on the counter. What else did he do? What did he do in the living room, remember? To flower over, so you can say Oliver. And what did he do? Knocked the flower. Okay, go. Count urge. Two letters, urge. Good. And how about Oliver? We need one more letter right here. Oliver. Good. Okay. What are you going to put at the end of your sentence? All right. Now, what happened? What is it doing? Something it has in the middle, Kevin.
Jelly.
Okay. That was in the beginning. Something he did in the middle. What else did Oliver do? He went to a different room. Can you pick a different room now? You know what he did in the living room? Remember he sing by the window? What does he do by the window? He knocked the flower pot over. So you're going to say, Oliver knocked the flower pot over. You tell me.
Knocked
the flower pot over. Again. Oliver knocked the flower pot over. Go. Oh, very good. Right, right here. Oh, that's wonderful. The flower. We can stop right there. Where are we, what are you going to put at the end of that? Keep it the flower. Were you going to add more to it? What were you going to say? Flower pot. Okay. Good. Now, can I help you right here? Flower. We need two letters that say er. You got it. Good. Flower pot. Excellent. Flower. Er. Remember two letters that say er. There you go. You knock the flower over. Can you do the over? Then, well, nice transition word, okay? What does he do at the end? What does he do? Good, then he spilled the powder. Good. Over. You're so close. The er says, what does the er look like? Not R-E, but got it. That's right. What letter do you need there? Good. Er. Two letters. Got it. Flower. Mm-hmm. Oh, what did he do last? Bedroom and what did he spill? Think about your pictures. Good girl. Okay, knock the flower pot over. Can you add over for me?
Over.
You need over right there. Think about the er. What two letters? Nice. What are you going to put there? Period. You're done. Okay, last thing he spilled. What did he spill at the very end? Oliver spilled the... Not that end. Think about the pictures. Remember he went to the bedroom. What did he spill in the bedroom? Good. So what is your sentence going to be? Oliver. Good. What did he do with that? Remember the last paper? Then he took a nap. Good. Now, because I know they're still working on structure, it's real important that they rehearse the sentence with you and you fix the structure for them, okay? And if you need to, make them repeat the structure over and over. Okay, I'm going to let you go one more minute and then we're going to stop. Oliver spilled the powder. Good, you're doing powder. Remember the owl part, like in down? Good, powder. That's right. Two letters. Beautiful. And you're done. Beautiful. Oh, my gosh. All right. Wow. You got one more word. I want you guys to reread, okay? And let's finish powder, okay? Remember the owl part, like in down? The two letters that say owl. Good. Powder. Uh-huh. Oh, I'm sorry, darling. Dur. There you go. Then your part. Beautiful. Okay, what do you need at the end? Beautiful. Wow. I'm gonna let each of you read your story, okay? But I want you to read it. Come here, and let me see. You wanna go first for me, Tommy? No, you don't wanna go first. Jalen, would you go first? Can you come and stand by me? Okay. So I thought it'd be nice to get it on the tape. What hard writers. My goodness gracious. Okay, Jalen, go ahead and read your story. Oh. Okay.
Oliver jumped on the windowsill and knocked the flower over. Oliver spilled the powder.
Beautiful.
Oliver jumped up on the counter. Knocked the flower pot over.
Spill the powder. Nice job. Your turn, Tommy. What's that, honey? You were just going to sit down. That's okay. Okay.
Oliver spilled the jam on the ground. Oliver went to the living room. He bit the flower pot. Then he spilled the powder. Then he took a nap.
I want you to go, this is your teaching point, I want you to go look at all of your writing, I want you to circle every ER chunk. Whenever you see an ER in the word, I want you to circle it. The ER chunk. Find how many ERs you can find. Each of you has to give me one word that had the ER chunk in it. Can you tell me one word?
I think that's it.
You want to do this one? Powder. Give me one word, Jalen, that has the ER in it.
Oliver.
Give me one that has the ER chunk in it.
Flower.
Good job. Okay, you guys go back to class. I'm going to keep your books, okay? You can put your pencils right there. Thank you. Yes, right
you
now. I do want
okay.
These, yes.
We have to go back to
kind of look at them and give you guys, you can hold it, okay? Kind of take a look at your writing. It might generate some questions that you have.
Kevin. Jan, if they forget to let you, do you ever let them go back to the text?
To spell?
No, to figure
out. Oh, yeah, if they can't remember, my prompt when they couldn't remember was think about the picture. If they couldn't have thought about the picture, then I would have shown them a picture.
You would have shown them.
I would have shown them a picture, yeah.
Say that again.
if they couldn't have remembered something, because I had to prompt some of them what happened next, and I said, think about another picture. And I think one of them, I really have to say now, remember where he, what did he do in the living room? And still didn't help. I said he jumped on the window, and then she finally said about the flower pot. But you could, I mean, they could, I don't want them to use the book so much because they tend to copy words out of the book. And I really want them to build this processing, not copying. But if they can't remember something, then they could use it. And I remember this would have actually happened on day two. So they would have had more time to read the story. And my teaching point on day two is almost always retell. So we would have had orally retold the story before they actually wrote.
Mm-hmm. You said... on the second day, they're going to reread that book and other books.
Yes.
Would you just have them have the book bag to pull their own choices out, or would you have two or three books already out? I'm just thinking, you know, mm-hmm. time can be lost just by grabbing the book bag from under the chair.
Exactly. Yeah. Usually what they do is they bring their bag of books and they mm-hmm. put it on the table with a little baggie. When they finish that one, it goes in the baggie and they pick out another
so
book.
So they pick them out.
And there's usually only about three in there to start with. Yeah. But they're all books they've read with you.
Yes.
Very important. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Don't you find that then they have trouble recalling beginning, middle, and end for the book that you want them to write about if they're reading other books?
Right. It, not usually, because I'll say, let's talk about Oliver now.
So review it before you do the writing.
Yeah. Oh, well, we talk about it before we do the writing. So let's go back. Day two,
oh, I see.
They would read Oliver first, and they would other
folding
books, and then we would, our teaching point always comes from Oliver.
Okay.
And then we would definitely go through the review, the retell of the book, and then the writing.
And I noticed you, I think I noticed you didn't really say beginning, middle, and end as
I
a
did.
Prompt.
Yeah.
Why was that, and when do you do that?
Yeah, I certainly could have. I wasn't sure if that they were familiar with the beginning, middle, and end.
Okay.
But when they're ready, I could say, today you're going to write a beginning, a middle, and an end. I don't think they would be ready to do that. It seems like I needed to prompt each of them for what happened next. But they'll get there. But, yeah, I probably should have said, today you're going to write a beginning, middle, and end. And then think about what happened at the beginning, the middle, and the end.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Do you ever have them, because I noticed he was having trouble just with his sentence, do you ever have them count the number of words and draw lines? So, like, he
if I thought that would, yeah, maybe that would have helped him.
Because he was having trouble
remembering,
you know, putting it all together and having that.
And that's how we started the year.
Right? Yes.
The dictated sentence,
right.
Me putting the line
right
down.
And was he new? Is he new or?
No, I think it's just the line. I mean, he's new to English, so
it's,
I think
that
it's the sentence structure,
exactly.
Getting it all straight.
So he was,
and he's also
pretty
a
sharp.
Perfectionist.
Yeah. He's a sharp kid.
He wants it to be right.
I put the word knocked in there.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't have knocked.
Right.
I put knocked in there, and he got NOC, which was good, but when he came back to read it, he didn't recognize knocked. But
we might even have to ask him if he really knows what it means.
Exactly. So, in retrospect, maybe, I mean, usually I only draw the lines that they can't space independently, but sometimes I think it does help remember their sentence. I probably wouldn't have them count the words, because I think then that's taking them away from the sentence. All of a sudden they're counting, I think they're going to forget it. So just repeat the sentence. I make them repeat it several times. Now the last sentence, I made it very short. You know, Oliver spilled the
powder,
and all he got was Oliver powder. So he kind of forgot spilled the when he was writing, but we were running out of time, and it was okay. It's interesting because he was the strongest reader,
mm-hmm.
but who's the strongest writer?
Tommy.
Mm-hmm.
It is. And it's true. It's true every day. And I think it's almost like the reading is a little bit, like he's, I don't know if it's mechanical for Kevin, but something's clicked in his mind. But producing that language is a lot harder because he's just learning English, and he don't think he hears a lot of English at home. So producing, you know, that much English is a lot.
So let's go back to that observation, because I think that was a good observation. So why do you think Kevin is stronger in reading?
Sharp, he picks it up, visual.
Visual.
Yeah.
He's remembering words
mm-hmm.
visually, okay? Why do you think Tommy is stronger in writing?
Because he's internalized it, he gets the story, he gets the meaning.
He gets
and
the
so,
meaning better,
so
he remembers
he
the story
what happened,
better.
And so, and then, and he was just, this one's more, you know, literal meaning,
mm-hmm.
and this one gets it and can
and he's got the language.
Mm-hmm.
He has stronger
yeah,
language
right.
than this one. So let's talk about Jaylen. She's not Esau.
She has some speech issues.
Yes.
Some language
and,
issues.
And language issues as well. Absolutely.
And she has a lot of difficulty with before and after. So beginning, middle, and end. I think when you ask her what happened in the middle, she doesn't have any idea what the word middle really means. Which
that's when I prompt her with, he went into the bedroom.
Yes, exactly.
Or living room,
you
or
need
something
to give
like
her,
because
even in math, if you say what comes after, what comes before, it's just a concept that for whatever, it's going to be forward, further, but
so
I don't think she truly understands beginning, middle, and end. Probably if we asked her to sequence each thing, it might, you know, like
she could.
I don't know, but that's a really hard concept for her.
And it would be, I mean, even I'm not positive. I mean, it was hard for me to sequence, and I'm, you know, an adult. So the prompting is okay. And in retrospect, what I could have done, which probably would have been a really good idea, is done, you know, beginning, middle, and end, and then say, so what was something he did at the beginning? You know, he jumped on the counter, he knocked over the jam, or he went in the kitchen. I could have done that. I could have put kitchen, and then I could have put living room, and I could have put bedroom. And that would have been a little bit of a plan to help them think about what happened. Or I could have put, this could have been the flour, this could have been the powder, and this could have been the jam. But I didn't want them to copy powder and flour, because I wanted to see, you know, obviously my teaching point was getting them to transfer that ER chunk. It's not firm yet, but by golly, whenever they're writing in guided writing, and there's an ER, I expect it to be settled right. Now, sometimes I attended to the OW, and sometimes I didn't, because I don't think the OW is quite as firm as the ER is. It's firm in reading. It was such a nice prompt because it was so much in the story. But I noticed with Jalen, like she said spill for spilled, but she didn't say spilled when she read the story, and then he spilled the, Oliver spilled the. Mm-hmm. So she's got that structure that's interfering with her hearing the ED, where the other ones, they were saying the D part, and sometimes they didn't put ED. But that wasn't my teaching focus for today. You don't want to put too much on their plate.
Right.
Another question. Yes.
Going back to day one, when they were reading, and you were helping Tommy, and Kevin got stuck, and I always have trouble with that because I see a kid who's just stopped, and I mean he was clearly stuck for a really long time, and I never know whether I should just keep
going or
stop.
If he stopped it for a really long time, and you notice it. I would probably say keep reading, okay, and then I would, hopefully he would keep reading, because they've got to learn to do that. I mean, I want them to problem solve, but they can't just get stuck there. If you can't figure it out, you just have to keep going. But then I would go to him and say, where was that tricky page?
Mm-hmm.
Now, interestingly, that was the page I had him read.
Right.
It was really coincidental. But when he came to dirt, he said dirt, and then he looked right up at me, because he was waiting for me to tell him he was right.
Yeah.
Didn't do it. I didn't tell him he was right.
But with a lot of kids I work with, the problem seems to be that they really don't care much about, or they don't pay much attention to meaning. And so they'll come to the word bone, and they'll just fly through it and say butter, or box, or whatever, and keep going. And so if I say keep reading, I worry that they're internalizing that you just get through it at first sentence.
Well, I would only tell them to keep reading is if you get stuck
really
you can't figure it out.
Okay.
And I'm working with somebody else.
Okay.
You go ahead and read on, and when I come back to you, I will ask you where that tricky part is for us to work on. Because what you're talking about the second time is totally different.
Right.
They're not monitoring.
Right.
And you know what? When they're not monitoring, you can't control that when you're not working with them.
Right.
But it's something you're going to really focus on. You know, see, these are patterns. Like, monitoring is a pattern. It's not something that you'll see one day.
Please excuse the interruption.
You will
recess
see
will
all
be outside today.
So
a
you know
schedule of locations for where recess will be, will be
quiet
hanging
today.
Outside the cafeteria.
I mean,
they're
good workers every day. They really are. But they're loud when they read. And they're sitting there, and you know, they're plugging their ears. And sometimes I give one of them a little tubaloo just because.
Okay,
I've got tubaloo thingamajig.
Well, these are actually quite much better than tubaloos. Why don't you pass these around? In fact, these are yours, okay?
All three?
Yes.
Oh,
so they put
it in heaven.
These are called whispers.
Yeah,
and if they say it too loud, it hurts their ears.
And also it seems like it would help the other two, because somehow they have something on their ear.
And see, I don't like the tubaloos, to tell you the truth, because they have to hold them.
Mm-hmm. I just wanted to give them something because.
Try those.
You know, I've been telling them whisper.
I think Jalen's like me. Like, this is my definition of a whisper. You know, I'm loud.
Yes, you were out, so to just play with them. I think that way, we're on three.
So, that's good. We'll use it.
Yeah, go ahead. Those are my calls. That's my present for you. Called whisper phones.
Oh, they'll be excited.
Yeah, and it really, because what you say, use a soft voice. The lower they are, the louder they are. Any other questions before we move to the last one?
I do have one more question.
Yes.
Do you have any other questions?
Yes.
I'm really having a hard time with children again. Just writing what happened in the first page or the last page.
Okay. Her question is a very good question. Do you have any scaffolds for children who have beginning, middle, and end? Yes. Sometimes what I'll do is, it's generally at a higher level, okay, is I'll write down a keyword on a post-it note.
I'm saying higher than DRA 10.
Well, it could be a 10, but okay. No lower than a 10.
Okay.
All right, so I might write flower pot, powder, jam on a post-it note, and I pass those keywords out, and I say, who has the one that started at the beginning, who has the word that happened in the middle, and then we retell that part of the story.
Okay.
And if they need to, they can use that plan to help them write their beginning, middle, and end.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yes, here's a right
there. So the whole idea, really, in fact, I did a beginning, middle, and end in Montgomery County with a group of fourth graders or fifth graders reading on a third grade level, and their problem is they don't plan before they write. And so there's very disorganized writing. And what I'm really teaching them is you need to think first and then plan and then write. So they're not thinking first about what happened at the beginning of the
letter.
Well, this group actually is the first time, they're making their debut today, because with the DRA, they're my only group that was 12, 13. It's a very mixed bag. I have one that has a speech IEP, so it's a little hard to understand at times, and that's affecting his writing. And then the other one is ESL, and her endings, and trying to work on some reading strategies for her, but she's coming along on her fluency, sight word vocabulary, and we're still trying to build that. My other one, Jaxie, is very slow. The 14 was at a fluency 1 and only 33 words per minute, but his comprehension was 19, and that's something that you said, like 20% of the kids mm-hmm. can do that. It's pretty amazing.
Mm-hmm.
But really slow, and he drags everything out. His retelling is unbelievable. Ian can't sit still. He'll get to the point in a retelling when he doesn't remember, and he'll say, I don't remember. But I got to get him to slow down to do a visual, monitor the visual as he's reading, because sometimes he breezes through that. But he is self-correcting, so it's really a mixed group that we're going to have.
What are their names? Ian?
Ian.
Jack.
Michelle. And Taylor.
Mm-hmm.
So if you notice things about, I'll tell you who their names are, so if you notice something about them, it'd be nice to bring that up, because sometimes I'm working over here and I don't see something over here. Like I didn't notice when my last friend had stopped dead in his tracks. With our lesson, usually at this level, you do not do sight words. The only reason we're doing sight words is because Ian doesn't have them.
Right.
At all. So
right.
Like was L-I-K. So the other kids are probably going to breeze through that part, but I just do that. Now you notice, though, I don't mess around with teaching the four steps of a sight word. So you just might want to do a little bit of review up there for children that are still not building that visual memory. I'm introducing change, minute, and apron. Apron, most children don't see an apron anymore, so I know my kids don't see an apron, and now see me cooking. minutes, you know, not very phonetic, and I don't know about change. Do you think I need to introduce change, or do you think we could get them? Because Mom says some things you can change, and some things you have to put up with.
Well, we've done a lot with CH and stuff.
So you think we should be able to figure that one out?
Yeah.
Okay, let's let them try that one.
Yeah.
All right, and we went back and forth between two different books, and I wanted to talk about that just a little bit because of text choice. I said to her, you know, this book is really good for retelling because there are a lot of details in this book. And at first we were thinking about moving on retelling. This book, there's mostly repetitive. It's not a lot of details in the book at all.
Right.
And I said, if you want to do the retelling, we should go with this book. If you want to do fluency, we should go with this one. So your choice is going to vary but based upon your focus. And we decided to go more for this one because we want to work on
fluency. I want to do fluency.
So that was kind of a fun thing. For word study, I noticed that two of the kids still have issues with silent E rule and blends, which at this level is where I address it. I don't really address it before that. You're not going to really see the transfer until about 12, 14 into the writing. The other two seem to be pretty strong with their word study, but we're going to go ahead and do it anyway so you see what it would look like. And then we're going to do a somebody wanted but so for the writing. And they haven't had that before. Once they've had it before, all you say is, okay, boys and girls, I want you to do a somebody wanted but so, and they'll be okay with thinking that about themselves, but of course, since today's the first time, I'm going to guide them through it. Come on in. There's Ian. Hi, Ian. And Rochelle. And Jack and Taylor. Do we have any more copies of the lesson plan?
This one?
Yeah. Go ahead and get your markers out, please. And your eraser.
Yeah, and I stepped up.
This is cool. All right, I'm Miss Jan. I'm going to be working with you today, so I've set my timer. We're going to start by having you write some words. Write the word like. Erase. Write the word know, like I know something. There's a silent letter in that one. I know. One more letter in that. Okay. There's a K is the first letter. And then the NO is in the middle, but the last letter is the W. No. Okay? Kind of like slow and snow. Erase. And then the last word is a real tricky word. It's the word why. Why did you do that, Mom said. Why? It starts with a W. No, you're close. W-H. Those question words start with W-H. Why, when, where. And then the last letter in why is, there we go. So I would put that tomorrow. We might... like they all got, so tomorrow we'll just review no and why, and you can review another word real quickly. Okay, very good, erase. Put your markers away. So it's just a little 30-second thing. Okay, we're going to read a story. I'm going to tell you about a story first. This story is called Pig Williams' Midnight Walk. There were this family of pigs, but there's one that was, what's that?
I know that story.
You've already read this story?
My friend has it in a class.
Okay, well, this is my turn now. So we're going to learn about Little Pig and what he does to keep his family awake at night. So go ahead and take a look at the pictures. Now, at this level, I don't do a page-by-page picture walk, but I am watching to see if they are constructing meaning from the pages. What do they like to do at the beginning of the story, boys and girls? Did you notice in the pictures? What do they like to do in the beginning?
Yeah, they like to run and eat.
Keep going. Then what do they like to do?
They like to sleep.
Sleep. Look at here. What's that? What's that problem? What do you think?
He's snoring.
So I want you to look at the pictures. Look at your pictures to think of what they do to try to solve that problem. Use your pictures to help you. How do they try to solve his snoring problem?
They put a thing over his nose.
Yeah, that's a scarf. They tied a scarf around his nose.
He's doing a sleepy walk and Faulkner is asleep.
Oh my gosh, yes. Now I want you to stop on page 14, okay? When you get to 14, I want you to stop because there is something I want to talk about on that page. One of them is looking through the pictures too quickly. These are doing it at night. You know what I'm saying? You really want them to construct meaning as they're looking at the picture. So we probably need to slow Ian down just a bit. On page 14, I want you to stop there. Let's see, right here. Boys and girls, I want you to look at what Mom is doing to catch William. That's called an apron. Have you ever seen your mom wear an apron?
Well, not very much.
No, not very much.
She don't have it.
No, we don't have any aprons. But that's what she's carrying that apron right there, okay? And when she saw William on the top of the barn, she said, "You get down here this minute." Can you find the word minute on this page 15? That's a little different, a little tricky word, minute. Okay, good. So I want you to go back to the beginning, read the story, and figure out all the little details. We're going to talk about the details of what William does as a problem in the story. Okay.
Once upon a time, there was a pig, and the pig
and a pig, and a pig, and a very, very small pig called Boogie. Only that is a big brother and a sister,
Start from the beginning. Read it again, or shall we?
Let's check our picture and see if that can help us. Where is he going? Across the swing bridge. There we go.
What?
Okay, so when it doesn't make sense, Taylor, you need to go back and check your picture to help you, okay? Because I noticed you didn't look at your picture. It's okay to look at your picture. Go. Are there any tricky pieces for you? Are there any tricky pages for you? Here's your picture to help you. So what would it be on the pig? It's the pig's what? Yeah, so what's another word for his snout? Where's your snout? What is this part of the pig? You see the little holes there? That's where he breathes. So that he's breathing out of his... His snout is the same thing as your nose. See, that's his nose. Okay? Read it.
Don't.
You can't.
Walking, William had a clock.
There was a clock and a pig and a pig and a pig.
Stop.
And a very, very
what should we read this page?
Every day, the big brother and sister ate and ate and ate and ate. They grew up and grew up in the middle. And every night at bedtime, all they wanted to do was sleep and sleep and sleep and sleep and sleep. But they grew because every night, as soon as he went to sleep, Pig Williams snored. He snored and snored and snored and snored. Pig Williams was a very small pig.
Okay, I'm going to have you guys stop. Stop, children, stop. You did a great job reading that story. Was there a funny part in the story?
Yeah.
What was the funny part, Jack?
When he woke up and he started walking.
Uh-huh. And what happened when he started to walk, Taylor?
He fell off the roof.
He walked up to the roof, didn't he? What made the pig start to walk in his sleep? Why did he start to walk?
The thing around his nose.
Very good.
I don't know why that happened. It doesn't make sense.
It doesn't make sense, does it? But some things we can change and some things we have to put up with, right? So what is another word for that thing around his nose? What was the word they used in the story? Mm-hmm. I'm going to ask Rochelle. What was the word they used in the story for the pig's nose?
Snout.
Very good. Okay, I wanted to talk to you about your fluency. Actually was really good. I was really impressed with that. We're going to turn to page 15. We're just going to do that together. But your reading like the mom would talk about it on page 15, we're just going to read that page together and put our expression in there. They were actually doing a really good job with expression. I mean, I'm not saying teachers lie or anything like that, but they were really good at fluency, Char.
It was the book.
You're right. It was the book. The book supported fluency. Yeah. So it was cool because it was very repetitive. Are you ready? Let's go. Get back. Come on. Ready? Like the mom would say.
Get back to bed, said Mother Pig. Get back to bed this minute. And don't get up again.
That's right. So there were two problems in the story. What was the first problem that they had? Thumbs up if you remember. What was the first problem? Two thumbs, three thumbs. What was the first problem? Remember, what was the problem they had with the little pig?
He was doing something that kept them awake at night. What was he doing, Michelle? Snoring. So the first problem is snoring. How did they solve that problem?
Tied a
scarf around his
nose.
Another word for nose is? Snout. Very good. And then what happens? What's the next problem, Jack?
And then he walked out of bed.
Right. So how did they solve that problem?
They didn't.
They didn't solve the problem? Okay. Well, let's go back to, when she says go back to bed this minute, look at this last page.
They did.
How did they solve the problem of him walking at night?
The mother caught mm-hmm. him.
Remember they put something around the pig's nose, yeah. right? Do you see it here?
No. Right, they took it off.
They took that off. So when he has the scarf around his nose, what does he do?
He walks.
When they take the scarf off of his nose, what does he do?
He doesn't walk around.
But what does he do?
He doesn't walk around.
He snores.
But if he closes the door and the windows and lock it all, then he can't get it.
Well, that was a good solution to the problem, and unfortunately they didn't think about that, did mm-hmm. they? So, okay. All right, we're going to do some word work. Go ahead and take your pencil and your marker. Okay. And what I'm going to have you do is draw a line down the middle of your board like this. Make a T-chart.
We can do a word sort.
Kind of. Yeah, kind of like that. Okay. Over here, I want you to write the word hot. And on the other side, I want you to write the word hope. Very good. And there's a silent E at the end of hope, because the O says O. So here's how we're going to play this game. Good, and write hope over here. I'm going to give you a word. If it has a short O sound, if it says ah, you're going to put it under hot, because this is a short O, ah, ah, ah. But if you hear the O sound in the word, you're going to put it under hope. And are you going to put an E at the end of it, Ian? Yes, you are. Okay, ready? All right, spot. Where are you going to put spot? Slop. Okay, slop. Slop. Okay, what did you write? Is it slop or slope? Slope. That's my next word, sweetie. Come over here and do slop. Okay, don't do it yet. Let her catch up with us. Sometimes it's not going to have an ah sound. You're going to have to listen to it, okay? Slope. Where are you going to put slope? Okay, there's a sound right in here.
O-P-E. All of these will have O-P-E.
No, they won't, because I'm going to be tricking you, because you're too smart. Okay. Okay, quick, honey. No, you were right. It is slop. It's not going to all have O-T. See, what they're used to doing is all rhyming families. The thing about the silent E rule, if I really want them to generalize the silent E rule, it's not about listening for the rhyming family, it's listening for the vowel. So I have to change up that last letter. Otherwise, they're only listening to the consonant sound and matching the consonant sound, but they're not attending to the vowel. So now it's going to get a little tricky, okay? Listen to this word. Grove. Say it, please. Grove. Do you hear the ah or the o? Grove. Okay. I'm going to put up a little bit of a blinder here. Okay. Say the word, please. Grove. What are you going to put there? Grove. Job. That's nice. And we need something, remember, because it says the O. Very good. Oh, this is right at their need. All right, listen to this one. Spoke. Where are you going to put spoke? I like the way Jack is saying it. He's saying it out loud. Spoke.
Spoke.
You're close. Whenever we have an oak, we don't use a C, but we use the other letter that makes that. You don't need the C. You only use a CK when it says like this one. You ready? Spock. Spock. Ah, ah, Spock.
Almost
what he did. But it's not, because it shouldn't go on this side, right?
If you're missing the vowel,
and you're so close, when you have a k at the end of ok, you need another letter. What do you need? Good job.
If you don't have a vowel,
you are so close. You need one more letter. Think about this. Ok, like duck. You need two letters at the end that say the k sound. C what? C K. There you go. Spock.
If you don't have like a vowel in one of these, okay, then it doesn't C-K. Make sense.
Okay.
Because
you have to have a vowel. You're right. Okay, we're doing one more, okay? No, actually, we're doing two more. Slob. Where are you going to put slob? Do you hear a ah or an o? Slob. You can see I'm making them think, and that's my goal. Nice job. Last one. Stove. Let's read our words down, ready? Let's go under hot and read them. Hot.
Spot.
Slot. What is that one?
Slop.
Slop. Next one?
Spock.
Spock.
Slob.
Slob.
Hope.
Change that to a B.
Hope.
Just a minute. We're waiting for Rochelle. Ready? Let's do it again. Hope.
Slow.
Slow.
Grow.
Spoke. And the last one?
Stove.
Stove. Beautiful job. Okay, put your markers up. And that will be the end of the lesson. I have 14 seconds left. Woohoo! All right. Now we're going to do a little bit of writing, okay? So let's pretend that this is tomorrow. Put your markers up and take out your pencils. And I'll take these up. You don't need them.
What is the long stick for?
What's the long stick for? That's for the kindergarten students. Put your names on your paper, please. I'm going to teach you something that you haven't learned before. All right. Today what we're going to do is we're going to write a somebody wanted but so. And what that is it's a summary of your story. Okay. So when I think about the somebody in the story, I'm going to think about the pigs. So your somebody is going to be the pigs. Would you please write down the pigs? That's the easy part. That's your somebody that we're going to talk about. I think you want to fix that, don't you? I think you want to fix that.
I have two things to fix.
You have two things to
Three.
Fix. Three things to fix. Okay. Okay, now the next word you're going to write is the word wanted. So right next to it, you're going to put the pigs wanted. The pigs wanted. Go ahead and write the word wanted.
What do you want the pig to be wanted?
Well, you're going to have to finish that part. So say the pigs wanted. Now, I let them copy wanted because I don't want that spelled wrong, but by the third time you do this, you won't have to show them wanted anymore. You'll just tell them the word and they'll have it. But I want them to do that one. Okay, now, all right, honey, you're going to put it right here. You're going to write a sentence. You're going to put the pigs wanted. Now, what did the pigs want to do? You need to finish that sentence. The pigs wanted. Finish the sentence. They did, but there was another thing they really wanted to do that was the problem in the story. What did they want to do? Oh, very good. They wanted to sleep, didn't they? Okay, so the pigs wanted to sleep. Okay, they're getting a little bit not quite where I want them to be. So let me help you with this, okay?
No, I did. The pigs wanted to stop the pig.
The pigs wanted to stop the pig.
From walking.
Okay. All right. But you know what? We're gonna have to stick with mine because yours isn't gonna work. So we're gonna have to do the pigs wanted to wanted to sleep. They wanted to sleep, right? That's their biggest problem. Is all these pigs here? These pigs right here. Their problem is they want to sleep. So that's what I want you to write. The pigs wanted to sleep. So fix it, please. I should have given more guidance. We should have talked about it first. So here, let's do that. Let's put your pencils down and let's talk about it, okay? Okay. The pigs wanted to sleep, but what was the problem?
They couldn't because he was snoring.
Because he was snoring.
Pig Willie was snoring.
So, what did they do?
They put sister
put right, you got it. Now I want you to write, okay? The pigs wanted to sleep, but... Tell me the but. But, what did you just tell me?
They couldn't
sleep. Tell me more. They couldn't sleep because...
Pig
one
snoring.
Go. But. You can do that, but what? Tell me what you're going to write, Taylor. But pig...
Snoring.
Tell me the rest of it. Good. They couldn't because...
I don't know how to fight because without knowing how to spell. I can
okay.
read it, but I can't
spell. Spell. Okay. Well, you know B.
Yeah.
Okay. You can just try it. Although, at this level, in my book, I have that personal word wall. I should have made copies of that in retrospect. That's a really good thing to have that to pass out when they're doing their writing. And that way, if they don't know how to spell a word, they can look at the personal word wall to help themselves. It's in the beginning of, it's in chapter 5. It's page
153.
You are so close. B-E. Here, why don't you find it on this?
Oh, B-E-C.
Let's find it here because...
Yeah, I got it.
Yeah, okay. You want to check because, well, Jack? Small pig, keep going. Good job. Because. You need to go a little bit for the B. Can you find because? That one right there. So say three letters. B, over here. Say three letters. B, E, C. Now go here and write three letters. B, E, C. Okay? Okay, keep going. I'm snoring. Okay, then go back and read it. Does that make sense? Good. So, what did they do? They're snoring. So, think about what they did. They stopped the snoring. So,
how do I just say will?
That's a good idea. Tell me how they stopped his snoring. So what did they do to stop his snoring? Oh, you're going to do that? Tell me your sentence, Ian. So?
They stopped the snoring by putting an apron, no, a scarf on his head.
On his head?
On his nose.
What's the word?
Nose.
But what's the other word for nose? Put it around here. There you go. I want snout in there. What are you looking for, Steve? Sister? That's not in there. You're going to stretch that one out.
What?
Was snoring.
What was the other one?
So his sister, you have to stretch that one out. Okay, would you read it, please? They couldn't sleep.
Because
they snored. So. Good girl, Michelle. Nice. Nice job. You are such a thinker, Taylor. Find a scarf. Where? Yep, it's in there. You want to look at they? Does that look right to you? Okay, now let's go back and see if there's something you want to check, okay? What do you think might go right there? Snoring. It's not a U. Any idea what it might be? Good. Good. Look at scarf. What do you think might that letter be? The R. What two letters say R? Good job. Excellent. And I'm going to let you look. There's two words. There's one word in this line and one word in this line. That's not spelled correctly. I think you have to figure them out. Which word do you think is not spelled correctly in this line? Yes, you're absolutely right. And could you find the word could? Try to see if you can find the word could. Let's see. You're close. What is the out? How do you spell out?
A.
Nope.
O-O.
Oh, out is O, not O-O.
O-U.
There you go. Excellent. And then you finished? I'm going to put excellent. Ow. It could be an O-W. Ow can make the O-W, but an out. You know how to spell out?
Yeah.
Okay, use that to help yourself. Good girl. Excellent. And then we would make it say couldn't. We need one more letter right there. All right, so writing at this stage, you're working more on, you know, they're really good at phonetic spelling. Excellent. But they do need to work a little bit more on their visual memory. So I would make a copy of this, and each one have their own copy. It's not that every single word has to be spelled correctly, but there are words that they can fix if they just look them up. And the more they spell because wrong, the more it's going to be internalized.
Well, don't we do that? I mean, we do that too.
Yes.
We even spell wrong.
We have to check. That's why I have spell check, is because that helps me with my spelling. Alrighty, are you? What do you think? You got a period and a capital letter at the end of your sentence?
Are we going to come back here tomorrow?
Would you like to come back here tomorrow?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm glad you would. You need something at the end of your sentence. I'd love to, but I have to go someplace else tomorrow. Okay, give me a hand. Thank you. Good job. Thank you,
boys.
Oh, I thought you had a quiz. Wait, wait,
wait.
What happened?
Yeah, they were good.
Very, very good. Good
job.
I'd take him in second grade. All right, questions? Or things you noticed, I missed.
I think you kind of answered this already, but about the, so you would give them all a personal word wall page at 14, like
yes.
14?
14 is when I usually started.
Mm-hmm. And then, would you, I mean, obviously when the one child, he basically appealed for that word, so you could put himself in there. The ones that aren't asking, or just sort of, you know, writing along, would you maybe pick one or two?
Yeah. I would do what I do with Rochelle. Mm-hmm. I put a little dot, and once you don't understand what that means, when I put a little dot in the margin, that means there's a word there that's on the word wall that I think they can fix. Now, actually, couldn't wasn't the one that I thought she would pick, because she didn't have because spelled correctly. So I thought that would be the one, and but I would only worry about one, and the other one was around.
Okay.
Now with Ian, it wasn't Ian, it was this little one. It was so cute because I had him look up because, and he says, oh yeah, I spelled it right. Well, he did not spell it right. So he's just, you know, there's, you know, Ian, he said, I know how to read that word, I just don't know how to spell it.
If it was a word that was in the book that they had just read, would you have them go back and find it in the text?
That is a good strategy, but it's usually not a very fast strategy. So it takes so much time that I found the personal word wall actually works better, because I think this should be in their writer's workshop folder as well, so that they're always going to have access to it. Not everybody, like the other group that I had, forget it. You know, they're not ready for that. They wouldn't know how to find the word on the chart. But by the time they're 14. But if it was a name, like if somebody had said, can I use the book to spell William? I would have said fine. So usually I let them cover the title. But then what happens when I have found is if I say you can use the book, then they're constantly looking through the book and they're not getting any writing done. Or they're copying a sentence out of the book. They find a sentence they like and that goes for it. So it is a good strategy. It's not necessarily one I use at this level, though.
But not Oliver, because you were looking for ER.
Yes. Now, the other group, I really don't let them copy out of the book because I'm really trying to build those skills. And in copying it, see, these kids already have skills. So it's okay for them to copy those other words. But like because, they might have thought, oh, I'm going to look for because in this book, it would take them forever to find it, and they wouldn't have gotten the writing down.
When do you think these kids will start to read silently? Or do you think some of these kids would? They were loud.
Mm-hmm.
But that didn't seem to bother the other ones, maybe because they've got more skills, and so they can deal with the noise.
Right.
So would we encourage them to read a little bit more quietly? I know that's a natural progression, and then they will start to read silently, but...
It is. Sometimes it does have to be taught, though.
Mm-hmm.
What I have seen is that usually children start to read silently when they get like 20, in the second grade level is where they naturally start to do
that. So if they're reading out loud at a 14, 16,
it's fine. Yeah, in fact, I want them to read out loud, but not quite as loud.
What sort of prompts do you use with children that are reading at a lower level when they come across a sound and they're having trouble with
it? See, I go for meaning
or
analogy. So if they miss the word while, then I'll show them smile. Or if they miss the word, now bike is going to be in the picture. So I have found that it bothered me for a while because I thought, we're spending all this time on Salani rule in kindergarten. And I just don't see the transfer of it at all. So when I looked at the writing of children, I noticed that around 12 is where I started to see them use the silent E rule correctly. And it wasn't just on words they knew. Now, I noticed tide. Would you look for tide? It's interesting how they spell tide. Okay. T-Y-E-D, I think, was Rochelle. How about Ian?
Oh.
I'd be surprised if you remembered to put the E.
Put a scarf.
He avoided that word. Okay. How about Jack?
Jack.
They tied. T-I-E-D. T-I-E-D. And how about this one? Taylor.
Michelle. T-E-Y-D. And Taylor. T-I-D-E.
Yeah.
Makes
the most sense. Yeah, it does. So T-I-E-D, of course, is how it's really spelled. But it's interesting how they're not ready. See, they don't, even though they can read that word, they have no trouble reading that word, they're not internalizing that word in spelling. I was just seeing if anybody would have generalized the silent E rule, which he did.
Mm-hmm.
So that made the most sense.
Yeah.
Kind of interesting.